The term economy originates from ancient Greek, meaning the management of a household. What is managed in our global household is the allocation of the Earth's resources to the entire human family. Efficiency of an economy should therefore be defined by how well these resources are managed to satisfy the basic needs of those 7 billion people. Corporations are the institutions responsible for the production of goods and the facilitation of employment. They are self-maximizing, inter-competitive global organizations which act primarily in the interest of monetary profit. Corporations are generally short-sighted. In order to meet their shareholders' requirements, their management needs to focus on maximizing profit on their next quarterly report. When CIOs from top asset management firms were asked about their investment time horizon, only 20% answered more than 1 year, while 55% said a quarter or less. A study conducted on the key factors of corporate decision-making revealed that 78% of managers would reject a net present value positive project if it would lower quarterly earnings below consensus expectations. The focus on such short-term investments constrains corporate institutions greatly in their ability to aim for greater goals, such as sustainability and progress. There is no doubt that there are companies whose management acts beyond the profit motive, focusing on so-called externalities, like environmental and social impacts, as well as monetary gain. Such corporate behavior is, however, the exception, as it is counter the principle of profit maximization, which underlies the entire economic system. For instance, a survey conducted in 2011 revealed that only 20% of international companies monitored their carbon footprint. The economy's basic underlying principle to competitively strive for self-interest penetrates society on multiple levels. Nation-states compete for resources, corporations compete for market share, and workers compete for wage-providing occupations and hence survival itself. The competitive nature of these institutions has been deeply integrated in our value system. This social environment conditions people from a very young age to only regard their own interests with the basic mentality that there is not enough for everybody. Such a competitive mindset is counter-human progress. It creates social fragmentation by monopolizing capital, justifies economic predation and warfare, and results in an overall hostile attitude in the populace.
I'll bash your dib!
The engine driving our economy is cyclical consumption. The underlying mechanisms of cyclical consumption are the exchange of goods for profit and the exchange of labor for income. A central aspect of this cycle is therefore the flow of capital. The level of growth of an economy is determined by the speed in which this cycle is accelerating. A low consumption rate results in less capital moving to production and hence to the employer. This lowers employment rates and therefore purchasing power, which gradually slows down cyclical consumption. It is therefore crucial to maintain a high level of consumption to ensure the continuation of this economic system. In the age of hunter-gatherer societies, there was no clear division of labor. The low output of the food production required the whole community to contribute to it. Only through the rise of agricultural revolution around 10,000 years ago, which made a production of food surplus possible, specialization was a viable option. Since then, there was always the necessity for the individual to be employed in order to earn their life ground, and for society to have people employed so that goods were being produced. Throughout history, the nature of employment underwent drastic change. With the Industrial Revolution, the majority of the population moved from the agricultural to the industrial sector. In more recent history, we can see a shift in employment from the industrial to the service sector. Such changes are always induced by the introduction of novel technology, which increases productivity and at the same time eliminates the need for many occupations. This trend of doing more with less, also known as ephemeralization, a term coined by inventor and futurist Richard Buckminster Fuller, increases production efficiency exponentially, replacing the human labor force at ever-accelerating rates. With the state of technology today, the majority of jobs could be automated by applying the latest machinery, electronics, and software. The potential to automate comprises a huge variety of occupations. Fully automated agriculture, automated restaurants and supermarkets or online shopping services, driverless automobiles guided by GPS and laser technology, construction of infrastructure through large-scale 3D printing, the use of robots in complex medical procedures, and so on. This means that the need for society to employ people in order to produce needed goods and services would decrease dramatically. However, in order to sustain cyclical consumption and in order for people to sustain themselves, the population must earn a salary. Due to the obligation to their employees, most corporations resist the urge to fully automate their labor force despite the obvious potential for profit. Still, due to the exponential progress in technology, automation is slowly putting more and more people out of jobs. Automation is in fact the main contributor to the high unemployment rates we see throughout the world today. This technological unemployment results in a lower purchasing power and puts the concept of cyclical consumption and the well-being of the population in jeopardy. While the automation of labor decreases employment rates, it simultaneously increases production efficiency, resulting in a surplus of goods unable to enter cyclical consumption due to the lack in purchasing power. With the technological potential to automate the majority of the workforce, the sole reason for the existence of most occupations is that a justification to supply people with financial means is needed. This means that the majority of potentially productive time of the individuals employed in such jobs is wasted on unnecessary and often dangerous tasks. Considering that, according to the Delaware Shift Index, 80% of the US workforce is dissatisfied with their jobs, it becomes obvious that this unnecessary employment has a dramatic negative impact on the overall well-being of the population. Regarding the inhumane working and living conditions of sweatshop employees throughout developing countries, this negative relationship is taken to the extreme. One way to ensure a high level of consumption is economic propaganda. It is used to manipulate the masses, altering their consumer habits and increasing their average spending. This is also known as advertising. Advertising came into being as a means to inform the consumer of the existence of offered goods and services. This would result in the consumer being able to satisfy their needs and the producer to earn their income. However, in the last few decades, advertising experienced a shift in both magnitude and purpose. This occurred mainly as a consequence to a goods surplus in the early 20th century. This overproduction was a result of the automation of labor through machine application. It was then decided that rather than using this increased production efficiency to benefit the population by reducing its working hours, to instead increase demand and ultimately consumption by generating culturally induced needs or wants through economic propaganda. Leading Wall Street banker Paul Mazur, working for Lehman Brothers at that time, suggested that we must shift America from a needs to a desires culture. People must be trained to desire, to want new things, even before the old have been entirely consumed. Man's desires must overshadow his needs. In 1955, economist Victor Lebeau stated, "Our enormously productive economy demands that we make consumption our way of life, that we convert the buying and use of goods into rituals, that we seek our spiritual satisfactions, our ego satisfactions, in consumption. The measure of social status, of social acceptance, of prestige is now to be found in our consumptive patterns. We need things consumed, burned up, worn out, replaced and discarded at an ever-increasing pace. Today, advertising no longer serves to inform the customer of the existence and benefit of a commodity. Rather, it aims at inducing an association between the product and prominent social urges. This trend resulted in a dramatic shift in consumer culture. By directly or subconsciously creating a connection between the advertised good or service and a specific societal status, a way of life, a sentimental value, or simply sexual stimulation, today's consumer is conditioned from a very early age to identify him or herself and the quality of his or her life through superficial characteristics, acquisition, and ownership. Such culturally induced wants then in turn influence the value system of a society, which further reinforces the societal institutions it is based upon. Besides the failing of such artificially generated values to function as a driver to satisfy human needs and therefore well-being, a destructive aspect of this new consumer culture is an ever-present inferiority complex in the population, which promotes increased consumption of goods that serve to emphasize one's status or to enhance superficial characteristics. A study conducted on the change of eating behaviors of Fijian girls upon prolonged exposure to television demonstrated the impact of Western media on the way adolescent girls perceive their own body. The traditional view of full healthy body features as the cultural norm changed drastically through the import of Western television, introducing eating disorders which were prior unheard of into the indigenous communities. By continuously being exposed to an unrealistic image of physical human features and the fabricated necessity to represent one's status in luxurious possessions, people are conditioned to feel inferior as long as they do not embody that which is taught to them by what Irving Goffman described as commercial realism, the distorted picture presented by advertising which is conditioned to be perceived as reality. While this indoctrination of the people to associate superficiality, consumption and ownership to self-actualization and happiness has dire consequences to human well-being, it is an incredibly effective driver for corporate profit and economic growth. We'll be right back. To ensure a sustainable and efficient economy, produced goods should be created to last. Built from durable materials and designed to be updatable, the production of such goods would avoid waste of materials and energy and minimize the need to dispose broken and obsolescent goods into our environment. This evident criteria for production that should lie at the heart of the economy is, however, impossible to apply in the current economic model. In order for a company to retain a competitive edge, it must maximize cost efficiency. This implies the reduction of expenses for labor, materials, and so on. This tendency of producing inferior goods in order to stay in business is termed competitive or intrinsic obsolescence. However, the enormous output of waste is not just the result of a need to maximize cost efficiency. It is also the consequence of the production of goods that are deliberately designed to have a limited lifespan or that are made obsolete by the succeeding product model. This conscious withdrawal of efficiency is also known as planned obsolescence, and it ensures that the market doesn't become saturated so that cyclical consumption may continue unhindered. In the 1930s, some economists even suggested to make planned obsolescence mandatory for industry to boost economic growth. One of the earliest and most famous applications of this economic principle was the significant reduction of the lifespan of light bulbs enforced by the Phoebus cartel in 1924. The average lifespan of incandescent light bulbs hasn't increased since. Many printers today contain EEPROM chips, which store the number of printed documents and lock up the printer once a certain threshold is reached. This forces the consumer to purchase a new model. When Apple first introduced the iPod, their product contained an unreplaceable lithium battery, which was designed with a limited lifespan of 18 months. While most corporations won't openly admit to such a strategy for obvious reasons, planned obsolescence has become an integral part of how goods are being designed and produced in the global economy. In the case of obsolescence being imposed through the introduction of a revised version of a commodity, it is also referred to as perceived obsolescence. It puts the consumer under pressure to keep purchasing for the perceived need or want to stay up to date with material possessions. Perceived obsolescence is especially relevant in the world of fashion, where products are constantly made obsolete by new trends which are defined by their short lifespan. The consumer is forced to submit through the creation of the social stigma of being out of fashion through economic propaganda. This corrupt behavior of deliberately creating obsolescent goods, which is a byproduct of our profit-driven economy, has dramatic consequences on our planet by plundering its resources and returning them into the environment in the form of waste. Also, by intentionally ignoring or even suppressing the appearance of technologies that could increase the lifespan of a given good and therefore threaten the speed of cyclical consumption, as well as the continuity of the service industry, progress that could achieve a sustainable and efficient economy is inhibited. The simple reason why produced commodities in our economy are always vastly inferior to the goods that could potentially be created by the standards of modern technology is that product efficiency and sustainability are inverse to economic growth. In our current economic model, resources are fed through the system in a linear fashion. First, they enter the industry through extraction by corporate institutions. As resources are usually not freely accessible, this often involves the destruction of ecosystems and the usage of vast amounts of energy. Those resources are then transferred to other corporate institutions to produce obsolete goods which enter cyclical consumption. Whilst small efforts exist in our economy to recycle resources, the vast majority end up in massive landfills, in our oceans, or get destroyed in incineration plants with obvious negative influences on our environment. On every level of resource management, from extraction, transportation, production, consumption to disposal, massive amounts of waste and harmful substances through the use of toxic chemicals and the burning of fossil fuels are released into the environment, threatening our ecosystem, the ultimate limiting factor for our very existence. This linear resource management is incredibly inefficient. Of all the materials that flow through the North American economy, only 1% end up and are still in use in products after 6 months of their sale. It should be no surprise then that within just 3 decades, 1/3 of the planet's resources have been consumed. The reason why resources are rather extracted than recycled, why goods are shipped around the world instead of being produced locally, wasting huge amounts of energy, why commodities are designed to break down and become obsolete rather than to last and be updatable, is not the lack of proper regulation of the economy or unethical behavior of corporate leaders. The true corruption is the basic underlying principle and driver of our economic model: the maximization of profit.